Right. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to you all to this, the 32nd meeting in 2015 of the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee. Can I welcome all members and welcome our witnesses who will come to in a second and guests in the gallery. And I remind everyone, please, to turn off or at least turn to silent all mobile phones and other electronic devices so they don't interfere with the sound equipment. We have apologies this morning from Patrick Harvey, who is running late. But should be with us shortly, and one of our witnesses, Felix Wight, who is running late, but should be with us shortly too. Item one on the agenda, can I ask if members are content that we take item four, a discussion on our work programme, in private?
Agreed.
That's agreed, thank you. Item two, can I ask if members are content that we consider a draft report on future prospects for oil and gas in Scotland in private at future meetings? We are agreed. Thank you very much. Item three on the agenda, we are going to take some evidence this morning on the future of renewable energy in Scotland. I think probably before I come to introduce that, I think it's quite helpful that we just went around the table and said who we all were and why we were here. So I'll start. I'm Murdo Fraser. I'm the convener of the committee, and I'm the Conservative MSP for Mid Scotland and Fife. I'll hand over to Dennis Robertson.
Yeah, and good morning. Dennis Robertson. I'm the Deputy Convener of the Committee, and I'm the SNP member for Aberdeenshire West.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Niall Stuart, the Chief Executive of Scottish Renewables, which is the representative voice for the sector in Scotland.
Good morning. I'm Chick Brodie. I'm a Regionalist MSP for the South of Scotland.
Good morning, John Forster, Chair of STA Scotland, that's Solar Trade Association, also on the board of STA for the UK. I also own a business, Forster Group, which is actually a range of businesses, one of which is a large solar installer here in Scotland.
Gordon MacDonald, MSP for Edinburgh Pentlands.
Good morning, I'm Mark Winskel. I'm Research Fellow in Energy Innovation at the University of Edinburgh, and I also work for the UK Energy Research Centre.
Good morning, Richard Lyle, MSP for Central Region.
I'm Keith Bell. I'm from the University of Strathclyde, where I occupy the Scottish Power Chair in Smart Grids. And like Mark, I'm also involved in the UK Energy Research Centre.
Lewis MacDonald, Labour MSP for North East Scotland.
Tony Mackay, an energy economist based in Inverness.
Joan Lamont, Labour and Co-op MSP for Glasgow Pollock. Joan McNaughton, I chair some work for the World Energy Council on the Energy Trilemma. And I'm on various other academic boards dealing with energy and climate policy, essentially.
I'm Joan McAlpine, MSP for the South of Scotland.
Hello, good morning. I'm Angus McCrone, Chief Editor of Bloomberg New Energy Finance. We're a business of about 200 people who crunch all the numbers and analyse in some depth all the trends in clean energy and the energy transition worldwide.
Okay. And we're also joined by the official reporters who are noting down everything you say. Alistair Reid, who's a senior researcher in SPICE on energy policy, and by our committee clerks, who are here to keep me right. I'd just like to welcome Felix Wight, who's just joining us from Community Energy Scotland. So welcome. So we're going to run this as a kind of roundtable format. I think we're going to run it for about 90 minutes or so. We'll try and finish by about 11:30 because the committee does have other business to discuss this morning. As it's a roundtable, I want to keep it as kind of free-flowing a discussion as we can. I urge everyone to make their points as briefly as they can. That would be very helpful. If people want to contribute, it'd be helpful if you just caught my eye, and I'll bring you in as best I can, as time allows, and particularly useful if you either agree vehemently or even more usefully disagree vehemently with a point that you've just heard made. Catch my eye and I will bring you in and allow you to contribute, and that way we'll get through the topics in the time available. I just want to start by setting the scene a bit as to why we're here. As we know, there's been a change in UK government since last May, a Conservative government elected with a manifesto pledge to end subsidies for onshore wind, or at least new projects for onshore wind. The renewable obligation will close from April 2016, but with grace periods in place, which you might have views on. There's a current consultation on controlling subsidies for solar PV, and also in relation to the feed-in tariff, which you might have views on. We had a speech last month from Amber Rudd, the Secretary of State at DEC, billed as a reset speech setting out the direction of UK government policy. A lot of discussion in that with a focus on offshore wind. Discussion around the future of marine energy. I noticed from Mr. Mackay's written submission, he had some comments around the future of marine energy, and that might be of interest. And we're also interested in talking around issues about not just renewable electricity, but renewable heat, where there have been some Treasury announcements. The Treasury, I see, according to the latest edition of Renewable Energy News, expect their managed expenditure on environmental levies, including renewable obligations, contracts for difference and feed-in tariffs, to double from 6.2 billion, more than double from 6.2 billion in 2015-16 to 13.8 billion in 2020-21. And the Treasury, as we know, are concerned about overall costs in the sector. On the top of all that, we've got Scottish Government's budget, which is due out a week today, which you might have a view on. And we have Scottish Parliament elections in May next year, which might have an impact. So there are a lot of things happening, a lot of moving parts in the equation. I thought it might be quite useful, maybe just as a starter, just to go round the witnesses. And maybe I'll just start with Niall Stuart at this side and work my way around. And just ask you all, just for a couple of minutes, set the scene, tell us what you think, where the sector is, what the major challenges are, and what you're looking for going forward. So if you try and do that fairly succinctly, that'd be very helpful. And I'll start with Niall Stuart.
Thank you, convener. I think I would echo some of the points we've made in our written evidence. I think the last decade has really been a success in terms of the very significant growth of renewables, particularly renewable power, but also significant growth in renewable heat and transport, although we probably are behind target in both of those areas. That's really been down to supportive policies here at Holyrood and also at Westminster. But I would say that the cuts to various schemes that you referred to already, closures to various support schemes, and delays in terms of timescales for the next allocation process for contracts for difference, means that the sector is in many ways in disarray at the moment. I think all those sudden changes have not been good for the people and companies who work in the sector, and we're seeing people leaving the sector, and they've not been good for companies and communities that want to invest in new projects. And I think in some ways that the tragedy in all of this, I would highlight two things. One is that to some extent it really stalls the momentum that the sector has made over the last decade. For example, in terms of pretty significant reductions in cost, both in onshore wind and offshore wind, for example, also significant cost reduction seen in solar. And the very sudden changes actually threaten progress on all of that. But I would actually say the most important thing is that these very sudden changes and the impact that they're having on the sector in many ways run counter to the UK government's overall ambitions in terms of climate change and their very often stated commitment to decarbonising the energy sector and the economy at the lowest cost to consumer. And we think that things like just removing all support for onshore wind, for example, and for solar very much run counter to that, given that those are the lowest cost forms, not just of renewables, but of low carbon power that we can deploy at scale. So I think those are the problems in terms of what we need for the future to get the industry looking forward again rather than looking backwards. I think it's some sense of ambition of what both the UK government and the Scottish government see as the role for renewables, not just out to 2020 and our 2020 targets, which have really been the focus till now, but what is the sense of ambitions for renewables beyond 2020, out to 2030, potentially even out to 2050, the role for renewables in the key overall challenge of decarbonising the energy sector and decarbonising the economy. And I think right now the industry, to a greater or less extent, is feeling its way in the dark as to what the overall ambitions for the sector are into the future.
Okay, thank you very much. John Forster.
I'm naturally going to speak on solar.
I would first of all congratulate, I think, the Scottish Government's commitment to the 2020 target of 100% renewables. Very good. And I should also add that since we set up STA Scotland back in March, albeit STA has been around since in the UK since 1978, the support from the team of the Scottish Government, the relevant teams, has been very good. However, the reality is that solar in particular is an under-deployed technology in Scotland. We are heading rapidly towards 9 gigawatts of solar in the UK. It would be logical to think, therefore, that we would be approaching 900 megawatts of solar in Scotland. And in reality, by the end of this year, we'll be lucky if we're, you know, getting past the 200 megawatts mark. So we are a long way off the mark. On the other hand, we do have a huge amount of wind, which has been incredibly successful. The trouble with that is if we're looking for a solution to renewables providing a long-term solution to our overall power needs, then we have to deal with the intermittency issue. And well proven now is the fact that wind and solar work well together, but with over 5 gigawatts of wind, by rights, we should have around about 2.5 gigawatts of solar by now, if we were to achieve some sort of balance. That combined with storage would be producing something akin to base load or along those lines. And that's an important difference to understand. Of course, solar will be, and as Niall's mentioned, solar and wind are the two lowest cost solar technologies. Solar, in reality, will be the first subsidy-free technology. As Solar Trade Association, we reckon that is around about 19 or 2020. It may come closer depending on the actions of the industry on the back of the cuts, but it will be undoubtedly, without any doubt whatsoever, it will be the first subsidy-free technology. It's also the technology that's closer to the consumer and the end user, and that's important for things like fuel poverty and things like cost reduction. And I think it's important to say this isn't just about generation numbers, although ultimately with a target like 100% electricity generated by renewables, it's all about top level and how many gigawatts you've got. But actually, you've got to bring it down to a user level. And whether that's fuel poverty, of which we have a major issue and is a major opportunity for solar in Scotland, or whether that's cost reduction in things like industry, where solar can play a huge role, then the potential is enormous. It also links well with other technological solutions. So things like storage, which we'll hear about, the way energy is used, consumed, the links in with transport and moving to more electrically based transport, all works well with a more electrically based economy, and obviously solar fits well into that at a user level. It's also got great local and long-term employment opportunities as opposed to some of the short-term employment opportunities that tend to go with some of the larger hits that you get from deployment. It's also a technology that in all of that has the potential to move very much from the carrot scenario where we've had big subsidies supporting big deployment to that post-subsidy, low-subsidy or subsidy-free scenario where either it will pay for itself or alternatively, as we've seen with the October 15 new building standards coming out, we see a massive uptake in solar coming up over the next few years on the back of those new building standards, because solar PV happens to be the best, cheapest, most accessible solution for the new build industry in Scotland. That doesn't bring out big numbers. Probably about by 2020, we reckon that'll probably be around about 72 megawatts of deployment per annum on about 24,000 new homes, assuming we can achieve the build targets that have been quoted. But this huge potential, commercial rooftop alone, at the scale it's at, if you look at the Scottish commercial rooftop size of that potential, that could actually deliver the entire remaining balance of our 50% of our renewable electricity that we're trying to get from renewables. That's how significant the opportunity is. And that's done at a consumer level, which is itself phenomenal. So I think it's probably time for a strategy rethink when you look at what we've done to date with this heavy weighting towards wind and the real missed opportunity for solar. And I don't blame that necessarily on any one party. I think there's lots of players in that. So it's about getting the deployment mix right. I do think it's about bridging the gap. Is there an opportunity for a Scottish feed-in tariff and RO? The costs of solar to get it to subsidy-free now are tiny in comparison to other solutions, let alone when you talk about the nuclear option. And really, you start getting down to marginal income, marginal cost, a little bit of support financially or a little bit of cost reduction because grid connection, for example, could be reduced or planning costs can be reduced. These are the little things that will bring about that parity or subsidy-free solar opportunity sooner rather than later. So there's a big part to play.
Thank you.
very much, John. You've slightly stretched my definition of 2 minutes, but I'll forgive you that for now. Okay, right. Mark Winskel, please.
Thanks. So, I mean, I agree with Neil's comment, actually, in that in many ways the last 10 years have been a success story. There's been broad political consensus, which has been very important at the UK level. We've seen very significant changes to the energy system during that period. So we've had a very considerable renewables expansion. We've had significant falls in energy demand, some of it policy-driven during that period. And we've had the significant decarbonisation of energy supply. So I think looking for signs of continued commitment to that. So Amber Rudd declared in her speech that the Climate Change Act was a good model. And she also suggested that the carbon price would need to escalate. So, I think there is still a political consensus at the UK level that the UK low-carbon transition is necessary and that we need to pursue this in the low, the least cost method. But there's obviously a lot of concerns in terms of practice and what we've seen in specific areas since May. And there's a whole list of those. I don't know how far we want to get into those, but I mean, I think alongside the renewables question, the issue of CCS and the withdrawal of £1 billion of demonstrator support funding has huge implications for the system transition, as articulated by RPP2, for example, and Scottish Government and fourth and fifth carbon budgets. I think the whole statement by UK government now is the need for a hard reset, which means quite major changes to the current policy regime. I don't think the evidence is necessarily suggesting that the hard reset is absolutely necessary. I think we've seen quite significant benefits from the introduction of EMR. Contracts for difference are proving to be an important mechanism for cost reduction in offshore wind, onshore wind. So the prospect there, and after one round, I think what we know about policy is that it takes some time to bed in, and that the investment community and everyone else associated in the industry need a period of learning around all kind of policy measures. I think the other thing that needs to be addressed is the extent to which gas is now seen as the preferred technology for investment in the 2020s. So the latest DEC revised energy projections to 2035 have quite a remarkable kind of, or quite a significant amount of extra gas built into the level deployed. So there's an extra 12 gigawatts on the system by 2035 compared to last year's projections. That just suggests that we're heading towards a much more gas-based system. That might be compatible with decarbonisation up to about 2030. I think after that and into the 2030s and beyond, there are serious questions about what that gas is going to do to the emissions intensity on the electricity system. So that some of the problems that are being created at the moment will manifest in the longer term. There are obviously shorter-term implications as well in terms of meeting the Renewables Energy Directive target, given that there's little prospect of more onshore wind being supported. So there are real concerns now about the delivery of policy targets, specifically to 2020, but also I think there's real kind of problems being stirred up for the future after 2030.
Okay, thank you. Keith Bell.
Okay, thank you. Danger of an outbreak of agreement on this half of the table anyway so far. I would also say that I think the deployment of renewables has been very successful. I think it still has a huge role to play. I think John is quite right to highlight the huge reduction in cost of solar PV. And I think we see some issues down south of how that is being used and whether the system issues are quite being managed in the way that arguably they should be. I think we have to recognise that the success of renewables and the reduction of cost, not just of solar PV, but also of onshore wind and offshore wind, has partly been facilitated by the financial support that's been given to them.
And I think it is quite right. One thing that I think I would agree with UK government is that we should be seeing those costs continue to come down. We should be encouraging that direction. That's absolutely correct. But if we try to look retrospectively, I think we have to accept that, the reduction of costs we've seen so far has been partly because of the support that's been given. Could we turn the clock back and optimise that level of support? Well, that's just not possible. What's happened has happened. The first rounds of the contracts for difference auctions look like they are doing the right kinds of things in terms of bringing about further reductions in cost. We still need to see how much of that capacity is actually going to be delivered. And as Niall and John and Mark have alluded to, quite what happens when these next rounds are going to be and what's going to be contracted for is a big open question. I think Mark has already mentioned this, the big challenges come actually after 2020. We have a lot of attention on whether we're going to meet the targets already been articulated, but decarbonisation of heat is a massive thing that we really need to take seriously. What John has said about the building stock and improvements and new standards is extremely important in that. The existing stock remains a challenge. The extent to which we decarbonise heat by electrifying it and then making use of a decarbonised electricity system, as distinct to other options, is still to be resolved, I think, about the most cost-effective way of doing it. Other options open up about combined heat and power, provided you're using renewable sources of power, district heating and so on. They all have massive capex implications. John mentioned operability of the system, absolutely right. There are ways of doing it, but of course, as an engineer, I would say, but they might cost you. And absolutely the thing to do is to make sure we minimise that cost. I think the electricity supply industry maybe has been a bit slow in getting around to it, but I think there are positive moves. I think there are now serious attempts to address those issues. And of course, storage, my final remark, has a big part to play. I don't think we should forget we've already been making massive use of storage. Coal stocks are a form of energy store, gas store. What we've done in electricity has been to make use of those stores at the right time, in the right way. That's what we've done for 50, 60 years. As we decarbonise, quite rightly, we're going to lose the coal stocks. And as Mark said, going through into the 2030s, we ought to be losing the resource of calling upon gas, except in a small way, or perhaps allied with CCS. What we're left with then is thermal storage, which remains cheap in comparison with batteries, but arguably we're not doing the best with it so far.
Thank you very much. Okay, Tony Mackay.
Thank you, Chairman. Some members of the committee will know I've had long-running arguments and disagreements with the Scottish Government over their energy policy, including regular arguments with my local MSP, who happens to be the minister. Electricity accounts for less than 20% of energy consumption in Scotland, and it's a relatively small producer of CO2 and other emissions. Oil, particularly road transport, is the biggest polluter. And gas, which is mainly used for domestic heating and cooking, is the second one. And I cannot understand the Scottish Government's obsession with electricity, because we should be doing much more, particularly with road transport, to reduce pollution. Electric vehicles, alternative fuels to diesel and petrol, the same with houses. So we can make much bigger contributions to environmental policies, CO2 emissions, by concentrating on road transport and, to a lesser extent, housing. And the second point that I'd like to make is, as an economist, that the subsidies for onshore wind have been far too high. From some work I've done recently, the rate of profit in onshore wind farms in Scotland is currently about 22% rate of return. The industry average is about 10%, and energy utilities like Scottish Power and SSC, most of them are happy to get 5% or 6% rates of return. So the subsidies, they might have been justified to begin with in the early days, but for the last few years, they've just been far too high. So from an economic point of view, it is sensible, not necessarily to eliminate them, but to cut them radically. And the third point I'd like to make, which I mentioned in my written submission, is that a lot of the R&D that Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Islands Enterprise have put into the renewable energy industry, particularly for wave energy has been badly used or misused. You probably know both Palamis and Aquamarine Power have gone out of business. Scottish Enterprise has lost about £20 million on those two companies, and Highlands and Islands Enterprise about £15 million. Now, it's very difficult to say, but I think that we could make much better use of the money, the public sector money, that we're putting into renewable energy.
Okay, thank you. Joan McNaughton.
Well, Convener, you did encourage us to engage in violent disagreement, and I'd just like to say that I think decarbonisation of the electricity sector is absolutely crucial. And it's crucial, actually, if we're going to succeed in improving the carbon emission performance of both transport and heat over the longer term. You don't have to do it with electricity, but electricity will probably end up being the right way to go over the longer term. Two points I wanted to make on that. And the first is that has already been partly alluded to by other colleagues, which is, you know, where are we going after 2020? We do need the vision, and not just the vision in terms of the overall carbon budget, but the roadmap of how we're going to get there. Because essentially, we're replacing a huge legacy capital stock, which has been built up over 100 years or more. And in order to do that in a way that is as affordable as possible, we need to know where we're going to end up and how we're going to do it. That does not imply government prescription of everything, but it does imply some principles. It implies a view about where the cost attribution will fall for the future. And I think that's highly relevant to judgments around which particular technologies are going to reach grid parity when. Because actually, it would be wrong, as I think may be being contemplated south of the border now, to load on a lot of upfront costs to the early movers in the renewable sector for system impacts. But equally, it would be wrong not to take account of the whole system costs of these renewables. So I think that's going to be an extremely important area in the future. It's one which is not receiving a lot of attention at the moment. On affordability, in the work that I lead for the World Energy Council, the relative affordability ranking of the UK has deteriorated significantly over the last 3 years, and that's largely down to renewable support schemes. That does not mean that you don't engage in support for renewables. It does mean that we probably didn't get the shape of all of those support schemes right. And what it means is we have to be very careful in our decisions for the future, that we decarbonise in the most affordable way. I agree with a lot of the comments that have been made around that, but I'd make one other, which is implied by the prospect of a new dash for gas. If it seems likely the current complete reduction in investment in the oil and gas sector upstream results in a bounce back of oil and gas prices at some point in the future, which also seems likely given that we expect shale gas production to peak in the US in the mid-20s, according to the International Energy Agency. If we make ourselves too dependent on gas, we're actually not optimising the affordability of the system. So I think a strong and healthy renewable sector is actually going to be a very valuable hedge against global wholesale movements in gas. So I would encourage us to explore, in rather more detail than I can in this brief introduction, some of the system implications, some of the crossovers with the gas strategy, and how we actually execute the policy in a way that delivers what we're trying to deliver, which is security of supply at the best affordable cost while decarbonising the electricity sector and indeed our energy sector generally.
Okay, thank you. Felix Wight.
Well, I thank the convener and the committee for your generous sense of time in terms of 2 minutes. And I hope that we have the same, I wish that we had the same generous sense of time in achieving our carbon ambitions. Alas, I think we do not. As reflects our membership, I'm really here today to focus on issues relating to the community energy sector in Scotland, which is a subset of the renewable energy sector as a whole, and the impact of the reset in Westminster. Looking at where we stand at the moment, Scotland certainly continues to lead in community energy in the UK. About a third of installed capacity is in the Western Isles alone. That's for the whole of the United Kingdom. And that basically reflects the scale of ambition and of Scottish communities, the opportunity that has been out there, but also the structural support from the Scottish Government. That's really what has made the same underlying support mechanism in the UK play out very differently for Scotland. So I think that leadership and that support that it continues is very important. The question we really face is what next? The 500 megawatt target for locally and community-owned energy has been a very important signal, but we're now effectively meeting that target. So we would like to see a clear signal of continued ambition within Scotland. But it remains the case that the challenges that have been touched on by the speakers already in terms of the more drastic than expected changes to renewables obligation, feed-in tariff, climate change levy, as well as the enterprise investment scheme, mean that I think just doing what we've done before won't be enough. And as Mr. Mackay has already said, we do need to be thinking about the integration of electricity with the wider energy system, particularly around transport and heat. And our view at Community Energy Scotland is that a greater focus on innovation and experimentation at the local level is one of the ways we can try and create a more integrated energy system through things like storage, local energy supply models, and demand side management. These things are already happening in Scotland. They've already been supported. But I think that needs to become really part of a greater part of the mainstream. And we need to redouble our efforts at this stage to build on what has been done so far, make sure all that capacity, learning, and skills in Scotland isn't lost, and that we work together to ensure that the success to date in terms of the really significant amount of renewable energy that's been installed so far in the next phase becomes much more about local ownership, control and participation in Scotland's renewable energy resources, because I think it's not just a question of adding more numbers onto the system, but making sure that renewables are the low cost and the profitable option ordinary people. And I'd be very happy to speak in more detail about some of the mechanisms for that, as well as the impact of the UK subsidy cuts, when we have more time.
Thank you. Okay, and lastly, Angus McCrone.
Well, thank you. I thought I'd just start with a little bit of international flavour. 2015 will be, by considerable margin, a record year for both solar and wind investment installation in terms of gigawatts worldwide. And it's also likely to be the first time that developing countries invest more in renewable energy, excluding large hydro, than developed economies. So that's really quite exciting. And all the time, costs have been coming down, but very, very sharply in case of solar, sort of more gradually in the case of wind. So if we look at the European context, the UK has actually been a relatively sensible promoter of renewable energy over the last few years. The line of investment has been sort of gradually upsloping, whereas if you look at countries like Spain, Italy and Germany, they actually invested a hell of a lot in solar at a point at which solar was many times the cost that it is now. So they've got a sort of legacy of having had those booms that they're really going to have to pay for in the future. In the case of the UK, the cost of the renewable energy support to date, even on the government's own figures, which I'll come to in a minute, translates into about half a cup of cappuccino per week per head of the population. So it's not a lot of money to pay, considering that we've raised the proportion of renewable energy generation from 6.7% in 2009 to 25% the second quarter of 2015. I take the point that Tony made about there being too much fat in the system. I think that's probably correct, but the CFD program has shown that auction systems can bargain costs down pretty effectively, and the first auction in that respect was very encouraging. And just on the UK government policy, I think there are one or two shaky foundations there. One is they're very insistent on energy security, but they're also emphasising gas in a big way. And those two things look somewhat incompatible to me, unless there's a domestic shale gas boom, which we don't really see any sign of. They're also hung up on the difference between baseload and intermittent, which I think has become increasingly simplistic as a notion as time's gone on. And thirdly, there's the levy control framework, or LCF, which we've dubbed low credibility figure, because there are several aspects of it that mean that you're only taking a very partial view of the overall costs. I'll mention just one, which is the wholesale price effect. So wind and solar are squashing down wholesale prices, and the effect of that is that the computed subsidy then goes up. The lower the wholesale prices, the higher the computed subsidy is. So they're almost kind of biting off their own tails, and there should be a more sophisticated way of measuring the cost of support. It's right to measure the cost of support, but it should be done in a more sophisticated way.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, that's taken up more than a third of our time, but I think it's been very useful in terms of setting the scene. If we can have slightly sharper responses in future, that would be quite helpful. Otherwise, we'll never get through all the topics we want to cover. I'm keen to bring in some members. Members have got questions I want to ask. I'm going to start with Dennis Robertson. And I think it would be helpful to members, rather than just throw open a question which you'll all want to answer, and then we'll get three questions in the remaining time. If we could maybe direct questions initially at one panel member, and then we can, if you want to come in and respond to something somebody else has said, just catch my eye and we'll do that. Anyway, I'll start with Dennis Robertson.
Thank you, Convener. A recent report from Ernst & Young has said there's been a reduction in investor confidence. But at a recent meeting of the Energy and Climate Change Committee in October at Westminster, Andrea Leadsom was saying that the UK remains an attractive place for investors. What's your sort of take on that? Ernst & Young, it's a decline in confidence, or Andrea Leadsom, we're still an attractive place for investors in renewables? Maybe Niall Stuart could.
So I think it's fairly unequivocal that the UK is a less attractive place to invest in renewables now than it was 6 months ago. And again, Ernst & Young have quantified that in their quarterly attractiveness index. To me, it's actually more fundamental than confidence. The reality is, if schemes can make the renewables obligation deadlines, as have been set out, if you've pre-accredited for the feed-in tariff or the renewable heat incentive, or you've been successful in bidding for a CFD, there is a viable investment case for your project, and you will be able, we think, in almost all cases, you will be able to access finance at a reasonable rate to take those projects forward. The converse of that is that if you're not able to make those schemes or do not have access to any of those schemes, there's probably no business case for future investment in your projects. And I was looking at some numbers from DEC this morning. So, for example, the closure of the renewables obligation will leave something like 1.7 gigawatts of onshore wind projects with effectively no route to market. To me, it's not really about confidence. It's about whether or not you've got a viable investment case. If you have, we think you'll be able to access finance, but there is a growing capacity of projects which simply don't have a business case for further investment.
Yeah, but policy decisions require the market to be either confident in the way forward in terms of stability, and it's some of the policy decisions that are being made at UK at the moment are being in terms of the obligations where the subsidies brought forward. In terms of the deadlines, I mean, surely that in itself is playing a major part in investor confidence.
So it's those policy decisions which create that very binary situation where you either have an investment case for your project or you don't.
Just to follow up on that, I mean, is this, that's the question to Neil Stewart, is this sector specific? Because I noticed when Amber Rudd made her speech a month ago, more or less, the response from Renewables UK to the announcements on offshore wind was very positive and said this set, in fact, well, there's a quote from Mass Smith at Renewable UK saying that Rudd's speech provides clarity on where the government stands on the future of offshore wind, which will give developers the confidence to invest in the British economy. So is it certain sectors which are more or less affected by this?
So I think different sectors are in a different position. The sector state's overall commitment was to a broad level of capacity by offshore wind through the 2020s, but very clearly caveated around certain levels of cost reduction being achieved by the sector. So we think that's a fair bargain. However, what we do not have is any sense of timings of future rounds of allocation. There's been significant delays already to allocation rounds for Contracts for Difference, and what our members who are in the offshore wind sector are telling us is that those delays are increasingly damaging, and it is vital that the first allocation round has taken place and has concluded by quarter four next year. But I think your question is a sector specific. I think there's an issue here around investment for all the power sector. So again, the sector state highlighted in her speech that the current market framework is not delivering power, not just in new renewables, but will not deliver investment in new nuclear without significant support from government and credit guarantees. But also, we're not seeing any investment in new gas-fired power generation at the moment. And again, it's very clearly committed the government to taking steps to increase subsidy support to gas-fired generation in order to get new gas-fired power into the system.
Okay. Gordon MacDonald, brief point.
The same point. Andrew Watkins, head of the Energy and Marine team at Carter Jonas, stated that the plans by the UK government to change its subsidies will kill off the solar and onshore wind industries in the UK from 2016 onwards. I'm just wondering what John thought about that.
Well, quite simply, as it stands, and I suppose it's easiest to use our recent jobs numbers that we had carried out. Ernst & Young produced their own numbers on this at the beginning of the week that were very similar. Solar in the UK closing on 35,000 jobs. We estimate, and Ernst & Young's figures, as I say, were broadly similar, so two different reports. We estimate that those will fall by around 27,000. So in Scotland's terms, we think there are just under 3,000 jobs in solar in Scotland. We see that falling by 2,400 jobs next year.
Right.
Happy to hear the views.
Okay, Richard, you caught me on next
thing. Yes, I think the question I was going to ask John Forster, and I'm quite concerned about that because I've got quite a number of solar jobs in my region, especially in Uddingston. At one point, people thought solar, you know, needed continuous sunshine. You know, you see all the, you know, California, etc. What do you think? Is there going to be any more solar farms? And would you agree with me? And I think you said in your opening statement that my view is that whenever we're building a house now, we should be putting solar on the roof. Do you agree that, you know, we're actually underestimating solar and we should be investing more? And I'm concerned about the statement you've just made about jobs.
Well, in practical terms, take solar farms and then take housing separately, for example. Solar farms, there are solar farms, a number being built right now. There's one being built between Dundee and Perth, for example, that's 14 megawatts, so that will be the largest to date. There's another one going on up in Angus at about 9.5. There are others in the pipeline, so some bigger than that. But the trouble is that's all activity through that will die next year, and that will be the end of it. It's worth mentioning, though, that there is quite a lot of activity around post-2020 developed solar. So that's large landowners in particular, with developers looking at potential to build post-2020. Now, that would reflect what I said earlier about solar being able to operate subsidy-free beyond that period. So that's clearly just backing up that estimate that subsidy-free is looming for solar, and as I said earlier, it will be the first technology to do so. The situation around domestic or residential new build, picking that example, that happens to be that new building standards set out, obviously, by Scottish Building Standards have been expected for a period of time now, have allowed the industry to work out what the best solution to meeting those building standards is, and it just happens to be that solar PV is the renewable
renewable solution to reduce carbon levels in new build homes. And because we have a now starting to boom housing industry and a big commitment towards new social housing, obviously announced recently, combine those two and what you get is a significant future for solar in particular within the new build sector. The difficulty with all these things is the time it takes. That new build out, it will take a while to get to the level of volume that I touched on in my opening words. I've just mentioned the solar farm opportunity sort of post 2020. We have an industry supporting nearly 3,000 jobs just now. In the interim, there is little hope for those jobs. There is no other opportunity. Niall's talked about it in the wider sectors like wind. There's no point in pretending those companies will be shutting down. They are already shutting down. Manufacturers, distributors, associated parties. Yes, of course, we're in a growing economy now and there's opportunities in other areas. Many of those companies, including our own, will have other businesses and other interests in other sectors and can redistribute those jobs. But we're still talking about we've created an infrastructure in Scotland and in the UK that is actually a centre of expertise for the world, quite honestly. It's well thought of. The UK development industry across all technologies is well thought of. And yet we're actually about to destroy it. Our consumers are going to spend the next 20 years paying for that investment. Not paying a great deal. It's the cappuccino mentioned earlier on. I think the last 4 years of feed-in tariff solar in the UK, we estimate have cost £1.33 per annum on the average consumer's bill. That doesn't seem like an awful lot of money, ten pence a month, just over, to support the solar industry for the last 4 years across the whole of the UK hasn't sounded to me like an overspend, which is where I thought the LCF reference earlier on was so appropriate.
Just a couple of follow-ups. And I just want to come in specifically on the solar point. It'd be good to hear views. But we have been here before, John, haven't we? Because I remember in 2011 we had all these predictions of devastation, which didn't come about. Are you just crying wolf again?
The answer is, of course, they did come about because at the peak of that boom in solar, there were over 8,000 installation companies in the UK registered. That has since fallen back to below 3,000. And what was interesting about that is Germany had been through the same issue a few years earlier, where it got to 55,000 installation companies and then fell back to 8,500 because of a similar cutting. So this model is actually not unusual. We've seen that this path trod before. Yes, there's been a 70% reduction in cost in solar panels, which is driven to a point where the lower levels of subsidy that happened overnight in 2011, the industry has managed to adjust. But we're still talking about an industry that's half the size it was at the peak of 2011. Unfortunately, these cuts are going to be so much greater.
Can I ask you about something else? Because this caught my eye yesterday. There was a recent ruling by the European Commission on import tariffs on Chinese solar panels, which, according to the Solar Trade Association, will have a detrimental impact. Can you say a little bit about the impact that will have?
Indeed, this is MIP, minimum import price, effectively a Chinese anti-dumping tariff introduced in December 2013. It was expected to end at the end of 2015. It was scheduled to do so. However, an organisation called ProSun, who represent the manufacturing bodies in Europe, have appealed to the Commissioner that it should be extended. The Commissioner announced the announcement you refer to was that he will now review that. The trouble with that review is it will take 12 to 15 months. And in that period, what was the expected reduction in costs that would have come on the back of this are not now going to happen. To put a number on that, Solar Power Europe, who represent all the trade bodies across Europe for solar, had estimated earlier this year that removal of MIP would lead to reduction in panels to the tune of perhaps as much as 25% based on global pricing. So unfortunately, one of the things as an industry we were hoping for was that potential for a very significant fall in prices. I think we expect falls in prices because the industry will under so much pressure, but not good enough to make up the difference.
But presumably if we were in this committee taking evidence from the manufacturers in Europe, they'd be saying this is a great decision by the European Commission.
Yes, not surprisingly, Angela Merkel has welcomed the decision. But unfortunately, across Europe, all the trade bodies who install have recognised that it is going to significantly depress insulation.
Does anybody else have a point they want to make on solar? Particularly, otherwise I'm happy to hear other issues. Right, Lewis McDonald, you come in.
Thanks very much, Convener. I want to follow up a couple of the points that came out from the initial introductory comments. One was around Community energy and the impact of that on the recent changes and the prospects for that going forward. I think Felix Wight said that the difference between essentially the funding mechanism, the support mechanisms are the same across the UK. The reason why Scotland's been so successful in community energy is because of the way that's been applied and the added value, if you like, of Scottish government policies over a considerable period of time. I wonder, given what we're now looking at, is potentially an end to new developments on both wind and solar at community scale. I wonder what mechanisms or policy applications will make a difference to that in Scotland now and over the next, in particular the next 2 or 3 years, and what can be done in order to ensure that the community energy model, which has been so successful, as you say, in the Western Isles, is applied elsewhere in Scotland.
Well, I think there's two routes. One is for the Scottish Government to continue to work with the UK Government, as it does, particularly around community energy. And one of the sort of faint hopes of the government's current deliberations in response to the feed-in tariff review is that there will be some additional safeguards or support for community energy schemes in particular under the feed-in tariff. And the sector as a whole across the UK has made quite clear recommendations on that front, practical recommendations about how support could be more targeted, bearing in mind that the feed-in tariff, when it was originally introduced as a policy, was meant to be for communities, households and other non-energy professionals. But looking at where that money has gone, about less than 1% of feed-in tariff installations today have gone towards communities. That's based on Ofgem's own figures. So in our view, there's quite strong grounds for saying whatever budget is remaining, that should be more targeted in line with original policy objectives. In terms of what can we do within Scotland, it's clearly quite challenging. But I think that the areas of opportunity are around innovation in energy storage, supply and demand-side management. And there are levers that the Scottish Government has to help support those kinds of projects. It's stuff that's happening across the UK. I'm sure Keith could talk about projects, you know, happening elsewhere. It's part of an ecosystem, but there is a particular focus in Scotland on what we can do to link the skills, the capacity of community organisations that have developed renewable energy projects or want to develop renewable energy projects to look on the other side of the fence at energy supply, distribution, storage and management. And that's not just electricity, but heat and transport as well. So I think there's an existing scheme, for example, called the Local Energy Challenge Fund that supported a number of schemes, and we hope that it will continue. I think it is a smaller toolbox than the UK as a whole. We can't do it, I think, without some alignment and continued support from UK energy policy, but that's why I would see the opportunities within Scotland.
Thank you.
Keith Bell, yeah.
Yeah, I think some of what's starting to emerge from the discussion just in the last few minutes has been some of the links, not just of the energy system, with the wider economy. You know, we talked about jobs in solar PV installation, the kind of German manufacturers' response to the perceived dumping of cheap panels from China. You know, the German industrial policy was about, a few years ago, trying to build a market for solar PV panels in order to build the manufacturing industry. I remember hearing a speech from a former German civil servant. He said, well, it's not as if Germany is the sunniest place in the world, but we want to make these jobs here, so we've got to create a market to create these jobs. And they succeeded. Unfortunately, then, they've seen the market for their manufacturers be undercut. And I think a lot of what Felix is talking about these the communities that can benefit from community energy, I think we should also recognise the community benefits that could come in. And I think, you know, Felix makes some very valid points about where those benefits have gone to. But whether those sorts of schemes develop or not, it's not just about a sort of a push from top down, it's also a pull from the community themselves, and how can we facilitate that. And a lot of that comes about, I think, because the alternatives are maybe quite limited, and that's just a factor of geography. You know, most of the sources of energy that we want to use, whether it's for heat or for light or for transport, are going to be variable, and indeed the need for energy is variable. So what do you do about those imbalances? Well, you can spill those out in time, that's what storage means, or you can spill them out in space. So if someone else has got a surplus at the moment, you've got a deficit and vice versa. And that's what networks do. And you get out into these more remote places and the networks are quite expensive, and actually storage technologies and other sorts of technologies become more cost competitive in comparison. But it doesn't necessarily mean that the whole thing is going to be cheap. And so that's where I think the kind of the local economic benefits become so important in terms of making a case for the investment that facilitates all sorts of other things in those kind of places. Exactly how we do that, that goes way beyond my kind of area of any sort of expertise. I'll leave that for others to discuss.
Okay, thanks. Okay, Lewis McDonald, you want to come back in?
Well, those were very useful comments. I wondered, in a sense, how you link those with some of the bigger questions around the overall energy balance, because a number of witnesses commented on how that is changing or is potentially changing. And I think on the one hand, there are things that can be done at a more community level, which we've heard a bit about, and I think that's good. But I'm also concerned to find out, I think, a little more about what witnesses think about the macro, some of the macro questions as well. Carbon capture was mentioned, for example, and how you attribute costs going forward, I think, was also very important. So I think that would be my other area that I'd be interested to get comments on, whether from those who've mentioned it already or from other witnesses.
Mark Winskel, yeah.
Yeah, I think one of the things that sort of matters at the system level is where scale still matters. So we have certain technologies like solar, which are very modular, which can work economically at different scales, community scale, even household scale. Not to say that ground-mounted solar farms aren't an important kind of, and perhaps a particularly economic way of deploying solar. But I think for things like CCS and for offshore wind, scale matters a great deal. So economies of scale still matter in big parts of the energy system. And I think that then becomes problematic because I think, the current kind of reluctance to support innovation of the kind that reduces the cost of these large technologies, which is about deployment support. So one thing the government is now saying it's going to do is spend more money on innovation. But the suggestion is, I think, that that's the longer-term view of spending money on research and development. And there is an argument in parts of the policy community that that's, you know, the best way of spending your research money. I think the evidence, you know, there's a lot of evidence that suggests the way these technologies actually get their cost down is by trial deployment, by demonstration projects. This is where, you know, you discover the cost of these things. It's very easy to kind of end up with very optimistic cost assessments in a system model, which would suggest, you know, you do a lot of things on CCS and offshore wind in the short term. I think what we've learned about those technologies, you know, doing the modelling work over the last 10 years is that you discover the cost by trying to build them. Now, the problem is that that requires significant capital sums. So, you know, I think whatever increase the UK government have announced that they would spend extra on R&D is just outweighed by the decision on 1 billion savings on the CCS demonstration program without any kind of suggestion that there is another route for CCS deployment. So, you know, the Committee on Climate Change in the recent fifth carbon budget advice are still saying CCS promises to reduce the cost of the UK decarbonisation transition by 50%. So there's a huge suggested role for CCS in the longer term. No suggestion that that's being faced up to at the moment. So where do we go? And, you know, apart from the fact that the way the decision was made lacked kind of any kind of forewarning for the industry and the research community, so that's automatically done quite a lot of damage. But I'm really concerned about these large-scale technologies that are still seen as a really big part of the solution that aren't seen as part of the innovation solution at the moment.
Joan McNaughton.
I'd like to come back on both the general point and on CCS, which at one point I knew rather a lot about and was engaged in. I agree absolutely with what Mark has said. It is not just about the cost. Actually, globally, The world can't meet the 2-degree target or whatever target is agreed in Paris without CCS, because although it has been typecast as a way of protecting coal, actually you've got to have it on gas-fired power generation. And you also need it. There is no other technology for so many of our industrial processes, refining and cement manufacture among them. So it was an extraordinary decision, a really bizarre decision at this point in time, so far down the road, for that money to have been withdrawn. And it leads me on to the general point, which is that there didn't seem to be a linkage across to any industrial policy, because we were building a supply chain. We have a lead in the UK. We have excellent storage for CO2, which would be usable by other countries in Europe who don't have storage capacity. And so as a long-term play for a growing market, which could provide a lot of benefits, industrial, commercial and otherwise, CCS, I think, ought to have been part of our vision for the energy sector, and not just for the electricity sector. And so I think that makes the general point which Keith mentioned and Lewis asked us about the macro impacts, which is that one is always at risk in this area of focusing on a bit of the problem and not thinking about co-costs and co-benefits. I mean, I don't dissent from Angus's points about the levy control framework, but the way it is calculated has caused the Treasury in London to say, well, we can't afford to put these burdens on cost, and we're on track. I mean, actually on track for the renewable target within the power sector by 2020. But that's a very short-term view. It's not taking account of the need for continuity, which you've heard about so eloquently from others in relation to solar, where once you destroy those skills in that supply chain, then it costs a lot of money to bring them back. It's not taking into account the medium to longer-term costs, and it's not taking into account the impact on cost of the damage to confidence. And that was an issue a moment ago, because actually it increases the perception of risk and that increases the cost of capital. And in the other point which I made in the introduction is that we have to look at this system as a whole. I mean, what is our vision actually for the grid? We inherited a gold-plated grid built under the nationally built. You can't expect people to build a replacement for that grid which is modern and which takes account of full innovation and enables us to do things like maximise our management of demand response, maximise the contribution of renewables by doing it piecemeal. So I think that's a really important issue. And how you attribute the costs of that grid to the users of the grid, either new people coming onto it or people who are actually on it, will affect fundamentally what the shape of your system is in the future, as well as the viability of some of these sectors.
Thank you. Right, I'm very conscious of the time. I've got lots of members who want to come in. And Lewis, I'm going to have to move on, I'm afraid, because I'm really short for time. Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. Good morning to witnesses. The last comment there about the vision about where we're going and also the use of the phrase industrial policy, I very much welcome, because I think it's been missing from some of the debate. We started with a question about how attractive an environment the UK is for investment, whether in solar or other sectors of renewables. And you can't answer that question without thinking, what are you trying to achieve? How much are we trying to achieve? The Climate Change Committees, the UK Climate Change Committee, operates a number of different scenarios for where it sees renewable energy generation going. The lowest end of that suggests at least a doubling of installed capacity and more than a doubling of electricity generation from renewables by 2030. Now, we're already looking like we may fall short of the 2020 target in Scotland as a result of UK changes. The higher end of those range of scenarios suggests a trebling or more than trebling of that installed capacity. So the question is very simple. Is the current UK policy or financial framework remotely compatible with any achievement within that range that the Climate Change Committee is saying is clearly necessary by 2030?
Angus, do you want to...
Thank you. I think the answer to that question is that there is some grounds for hope in the sense that we talked about the difference. It was Niall who talked about the difference between offshore wind and the other sectors in terms of investor confidence. I think the offshore wind sector has been careful to cuddle the UK government close and to be supportive in the hope that it will continue to get CFD support. And the proof of the pudding will be in eating, but there is some hope that that will continue to happen. I think that's very important because offshore wind is probably the one of the three major technologies where the UK has got the most potential to export expertise and create supply chain jobs. That's very important. The other thing is the government has mentioned on a number of, I'm talking about the UK government here, has mentioned on a number of occasions the possibility of a subsidy-free CFD for onshore wind and solar. And quite what that means is unclear because with both of those technologies, you're not going to get anything built just on the basis of wholesale prices. Because if you have a windy day, there's a lot of generation, the wholesale price will kind of tend towards zero. So there has to be a mechanism for actually giving some sort of tariff certainty there. So what that is and whether it's subsidy free or not is an interesting question.
That it's unclear what it means doesn't sound like it's grounds for hope.
Well, no, I think it's grounds for hope because it sort of gets round the rhetoric from the UK government about we will not subsidise these technologies any further. If it can come up with a sort of form of words that enables them to say that it's subsidy-free, then I think there's room for something to go forward. And actually, Scottish Renewables has talked about a figure of, was it £80 as being a possible... per megawatt hour as possible definition of subsidy free. And we can argue about whether that's too high a figure or not, but it might be possible to bridge the divide in rhetoric between the UK government and the industry and come up with some kind of figure that both could agree was subsidy free in terms of the CFD.
Briefly, yeah. And I'll hear from Tony Mackay on this in a second. So,
I'm wary of jumping in and allowing Patrick to put words in my mouth. I can't remember the precise question, but let me answer it. Let me answer it this way. I don't see that we have a policy framework in place at the moment that will deliver the scale of renewables that the Committee on Climate Change clearly believe is required to hit future carbon budgets in the way that keeps costs down for consumers. We think that onshore wind and solar can make a significant contribution to the scale of capacity set out by the Committee on Climate Change. And we believe that is best done by continued, although reducing, support from the UK government, and that would best be achieved by implementing some kind of contract for difference at a level that we could agree was subsidy-free. So it wasn't Scottish Renewables who came up with the figure of £80 a megawatt hour. It was the Committee on Climate Change has asserted that anything at or below £80 a megawatt hour should be considered subsidy-free because it is below the cost of alternative generation, i.e. new build gas generation plus carbon costs.
That was 92. Tony Mackay, do you have a view on this question of costs?
No, I agree with Angus and Patrick that the current policies at the UK level are, if not shambolic, they're changing and creating a lot of uncertainty. But one point I wanted to make was that a very small proportion of the equipment that's going into the wind farms, both onshore and offshore, and the marine energy projects in the Pent and Firth, is actually built in Scotland. Now, some of the older members of the committee might remember the Offshore Supplies Office.
I do.
When the oil and gas industry was being developed in the North Sea, the government set up this body called the OSO, the Offshore Supplies Office, and it had a policy or a target of making sure that at least 70% of the work on the North Sea oil fields was done in the UK. And it worked. You might remember the old fabrication yards at Nigg and Ardis here and elsewhere. Now, I would say that the share, the UK's share of the renewable energy, including possibly the solar, is probably about 10%. The turbines are all been built overseas. Statoil last week placed the contract for this new floating wind farm off Peterhead. And the contract's gone to Siemens, who are going to build the turbines in Germany. So the UK content of a lot of these developments is tiny. And because of that, the number of jobs and the supply chain is similarly tiny.
Okay, thank you. Right, Joan Lamont, come here.
I was interested in people's views on what they perceive the UK government's motive to be in this regard. If there was a consensus around renewables, why are they just simply causing chaos? And I wondered whether, to some extent, it reflects what is evident in some local communities, that there is an exasperation about the level of onshore wind turbines and a sense that you'll never generate any interest in offshore or tidal or wave or whatever because the subsidies sit there for onshore. Do you think that is what's happening and how would you address that? Or is there something else that's driving us? Have they fallen out of love with the idea of renewables altogether? Just of interest people's views on that. And the second point is around community energy. Because I believe that one of the strongest arguments for community energy initiatives is it's the economic impact in the local community within which they're developed. So in fragile communities, they create jobs, they create economic opportunities, and they might stabilise the economy. And I just wonder if anybody knows whether that has in any way been quantified, because if it simply doesn't really make a difference, then why would you spend a little bit more on one turbine or two turbines? But if it does make a difference, it's obviously something you should then be strategic about and create an incentive around.
Okay, I'll let Felix White answer the second question while you apply your minds to the first question. So I'll let Felix.
Oh, right, okay. In terms of the difference, the figures that we generally use are that for under the old model, sort of a 1 megawatt wind turbine would generally generate about £5,000 worth of income for some sort of community benefit scheme. If that wind turbine was community owned, that figure would be £100,000. So the difference is material. It can't be applied in all circumstances, and we certainly don't believe that community ownership is the only model. But is there space for more of it? Yes. And I think particularly as we look at the opportunities that have come up on publicly owned land through things like the Forestry Commission's schemes for community investment, there is a real opportunity for that to be a bigger part of the mix. And it does make a real difference, not just financially, but in terms of attitudes. There have been survey after survey that demonstrates that local ownership is something that most people are overwhelmingly in support of. And in terms of planning outcomes, over 90% of community schemes have a successful planning outcome. So it's not just in terms of local support, it's also through the planning process that gets recognised.
So there's economic benefit to a local community, and because people like it, it encourages people to move towards renewables. Is there a strategic approach to encouraging communities to do this, or is it entirely happenstance?
We believe that from the UK government's approach, it hasn't been very focused in supporting community energy. Belatedly, it launched the Community Energy Strategy in 2014, but really that hasn't led to material support for communities, which is why we hope that at this juncture now, with the feed-in tariff all but over, they will, sort of from the ashes, use the remaining funds to provide more focused support. Within Scotland, yes, there has been focused support through the Scottish Government's CARES programme, but that really tries to make the most of the materials that are made available by the UK Government rather than releasing significant funds within Scotland for community schemes.
Thank you.
Keith Bell and then John Forster.
Yeah, I think we can all speculate in the same way about the motivation of the UK Government, and I don't have any direct line in there, of course, but it's clearly been documented that there's opposition from a lot of the shires to development of wind turbines in respect of the reduction of support for solar PV. I guess John would have a view, but maybe in some way, ironically, the success in the cost reduction has sort of made them believe it's more successful than it has been. Why are they so in favour of offshore wind and of nuclear power, and why they've withdrawn the support, as Joan was talking about, to CCS? I think that's a slightly harder question. It doesn't seem to tally with what they claim about reducing cost to consumers, because in terms of low-carbon energy, nuclear power and offshore wind are pretty expensive ways of doing it relative to the other options. Although, as Angus said, there's some areas of potential other economic benefits from that. So that'd be the first time they've come up with some industrial strategy that's linked in with it, even if they haven't said it. I think what Mark said about big technologies is really important, and the way that one learns by doing. When we had the financial crisis a few years ago, people talked about the banks being too big to fail. Well, maybe in some way, nuclear power and CCS are almost too big to succeed. It takes a huge amount of investment and effort to get behind it. I don't know, there is gossip I've heard. It's nothing more than that about why they've withdrawn the support for the CCS competition. One is that they've only got one competitor, so they're not just going to give it to them. And the other is that, well, actually, it's some of the big energy companies globally are interested in this. Some of the partners in both White Rose and the Peterhead scheme, big global companies, are they, maybe, this is some of the rationale, I don't know, should have the wherewithal to put their investment in and get the benefits from it. But I'm sure Joan would have more insight into that than I've got.
Thank you.
John Foster.
to answer your first question, it would be reasonable to assume that from the range of subsidies that have been cut and the range of technological solutions and the range of scenarios and scales that have all been cut simultaneously, if you take domestic feed-in tariff, it might be that people are worried about wind turbines, but I think to cut that tariff by 87% for solar really shows, that the decision-making has got nothing to do with whether somebody dislikes a solar farm or a wind farm. So somewhere in there, there are other drivers. And I think for most of us who are close enough to it, we probably believe that it's coming from Treasury as opposed to DEC, even though DEC are making all the announcements at the end of the day. So answers that point. I think just picking out one or two others is very briefly there. I think recognition that there's a need for traditional generation is quite widespread within the renewable sector. So for those that have made the points around that are questions. But a decarbonised solution, so hence obviously support for the concept of gas with carbon capture. But equally, it's this idea of a devolved energy and devolved use is really the future and the long term. We've talked a bit about long term thinking. What are we doing about long term thinking? And I paint a very quick scenario that I've used a number of times recently, and it seems to work. And it's about what a new house might look like in just 5 years from now, where we build a new home. On the roof of it, there's solar PV and solar thermal for hot water. There's storage for both inside the home. The car that pulls up outside the house is hydrogen fuel cell with an electric battery in it for most of its power source. In the summertime, the excess power created by the PV in the house will charge up the car. And in the wintertime, when the house is a bit short, the car will charge up the house's battery system to support the house for the next 24 hours. And you'll top up the hydrogen when you're down at Tesco's. Those technologies exist now. You can buy them all right now. What does that mean? That means that house will virtually not need large energy. Yeah, it'll still be connected, but it will have little use for it. It'll provide its own solutions. There'll be self-funding solutions because the cost of energy will rise inevitably, particularly when you look at the cost of, like, the Hinkley. The Hinkley example is a great one for just how expensive energy is going to become. If we think it's expensive to support energy now, wait till we get, 5 or 10 years from now, and it's going to look really scary. So the solutions, the potential for manufacturing, all the other things we've talked about are hidden in that little model that I've given you there. Those are realistic. And by the way, you'll be able to drive up to the house and there'll be a plate charger and you wouldn't need to plug it into the house and it'll connect itself.
Okay. Mark wants to go first and then you'll see.
I think it's quite important in sort of having this kind of discussion is that we kind of try and understand where UK government has got itself to. And what they are saying actually in terms of the latest projections is that they expect the electricity industry, supply industry carbon intensity to be about 100 grams CO2 per kilowatt by 2030. Now, that is on the upper range of where the CCC want this to be. It's on the absolute upper limit, but they are still projecting a very significant decarbonisation of the electricity system. So we have to, you know, the government have not abandoned the commitments in the Climate Change Act. And, you know, we have to sort of recognise that they see a consistency between a much bigger role for gas in the 2020s, conditional support for offshore wind, with the meeting of the carbon budgets. Now, that, you know, I think we have to kind of maintain that. We have to kind of keep that to account. I think there's a legitimate concern about the LCF going up to, you know, the maximum headroom by 2020. I think that's a very legitimate concern. I mean, you mentioned a higher figure, actually. You said 13 billion would be well above the headroom. So I think, you know, to some extent, some of this was going to happen. And I, you know, I think the question is, what do we want from a government who are looking to do a rational kind of economic relook at the policy? And I think that means sort of accepting that some of this direction of travel would have been happening. But I think what has kind of put a large part of the research community and the industry into consternation is just the haphazard nature of the way this has been done. The policy announcements have been made without any sense of a system view. When I read the latest energy projections, there is no suggestion that there is a very strong commitment to a longer-term transition after 2030. That's just not there at all. We're storing up problems in the terms of the kind of, you know, the gas plant stock that's being built or suggested that is going to be built. So, I think there's a kind of understandable kind of reining back in of the subsidy regime. But I think what's missing alongside that is a kind of commitment over the longer term. I mean, I think, you know, the community question, I do think, you know, the question of system cost of intermittency also was going to have another look at. I think the problem is that, as being proposed in Amber Rudd's speech, is that she's suggesting that every intermittent source has to bid independently of itself as firm power. So again, there's a lack of a system view. How do you balance the system? How are the costs of intermittency borne across the system? The danger is, with a view that every intermittent source has to contract for its own backup, for its own reserve, that you have, you know, a great loss of all the benefits of the system at scale to supply that much more affordably. So I think some of this is legitimate concern, but I think the way it's been gone about is probably, you know, far from economically optimal.
Brief comment from Neil Stuart.
So rather than talk about the motives, I want to talk about the narrative that's been presented around it, and that's very much been around the cost of onshore wind and solar, despite the fact they are, the latest projects are 14% cheaper than the deal that's been agreed with Hinkley Point nuclear power station, and that they are the lowest cost, low carbon technologies that can be deployed at scale. There's also been a focus around intermittency, despite the fact that actually gas and renewables are potentially a very good fit for the future energy system. And then clearly, I would say the government, the party of government, obviously feels that it plays out well with their, what they would say is their constituency, despite the fact that every survey has shown something like 2/3 of people in Scotland and across the UK support the growth of onshore wind. Very briefly on communities and jobs. So again, Business Innovation Skills Department published a study in March earlier this year. It showed very clearly 21,000 jobs supported by the wider renewable sector across Scotland, and those are very much geographically spread, diffuse around communities all over Scotland. One of the ways that communities have funded their projects is through local share offers or local funding rounds, and actually I think there's a big opportunity for us to scale those up and actually do something on a national scale that then allows us to widen ownership of the sector through some kind of bond or some kind of nationwide investment scheme to really widen ownership of the sector. Or we can possibly achieve the same outcome if we see more public pension schemes investing in the sector. And at the moment, I think it's only the Strathclyde pension scheme that's really invested in the sector, and it's at a very, very small scale, which is a $10 million investment with the Green Investment Bank. So I think there are plenty of ways in which we can redefine community ownership and also widen ownership of renewables in Scotland.
Do you not accept that there are places in Scotland where they feel there's an over-concentration of wind farms, particular areas? And that, do you not accept at all that there may be an argument that there's no incentive to research and develop offshore because onshore is doing very nicely, thank you, financially. It stacks up. How do you, or do you not think there should be that shift towards offshore?
So I think there's still plenty of scope for the growth of onshore wind. There are schemes which have already got consent, which our members are telling us they're not going to invest in and build out because they've missed the opportunity, they missed the deadlines for the RO, they haven't been successful in the bid for CFD. So there are already schemes which are consented which will not be built because they don't have a viable investment case. And I think you have to look at offshore and onshore wind separately. So there is plenty of interest in offshore wind, but the people who want to develop offshore wind are waiting on the next auction round to be taken forward by the UK government.
Okay, I'm very conscious of time. It's 11:30. We said we'd run for 90 minutes. I'm minded to run to 11:45. Which gives us a little bit of extra time, but we'll serve very tight for time. I've got three members who haven't had a chance to say anything yet, who've been very patient, so I'll need to go to them first. So we'll start with Joan McAlpin, and then Chick Brody, and then Gordon MacDonald. And then if we have any time, we'll bring other people in, but I'm not sure we will. Joan.
Thank you very much, Convener. I just wanted to concentrate on the technology we haven't said enough a lot about so far, which is marine renewables, and we had a very interesting session earlier this year in April on marine renewables. And what came out of that, we had Niall Kermode from the European Marine Energy Centre in Orkney speaking to us, and one of the points that he made, which kind of relates to what Tony Mackay talked about developing technology out with the UK, was he compared the way we treat marine technology with the way the Danes invested in wind going back several decades. And he talked about how the Danes kept faith with wind even when they had setbacks, and as a result of that steady investment, they are now supplying turbines and they're leaders all over the world. Whereas what he said was going wrong with marine technology was that we had been too focused on getting a very quick return. We were rewarding the UK electricity market rewarded companies in terms of the amount of electricity they could produce quickly, and that had resulted in setbacks. And their real fear was that because there had been this initial setback, they were going to lose faith with marine, and others would then take over in terms of the markets. They also commented that they felt that contracts for difference was inappropriate for marine technology, and also that investors didn't have confidence because of the failure to guarantee the kind of grid and the kind of interconnections that were needed to support marine going forward. And I just wondered if some of our panellists would want to reflect on that and if they recognise those concerns.
Maybe start with you, Tony Mackay. You do say in your written submission quite a lot about marine energy, and you make some comments about Wave Energy Scotland. Do you want to respond to that question?
Yes, I'm an economist, not an engineer, but I have a friend that's worked at EMEC in Orkney for many years, and he said to me repeatedly that a lot of the R&D work that was going on there by Aquamarine and Palamis and other companies was never going to be viable. And he's an engineer, so he was saying from a technical point of view, these projects were never going to become commercial. Now, again, as an economist, my impression is that there are tremendous opportunities, realistic opportunities in tidal energy. I was over in Nova Scotia recently, and they made a lot of progress in the Bay of Fundy there. So I think that in maybe 3 or 4 years, we will have some commercial tidal energy projects. But I just feel that, the 20 or 30 million that we've lost, or the public sector's lost on the wave energy projects, you know, could have been better used.
I think certainly Neil Cormode had said that, yeah, actually with emerging technologies, you do need to fail before you're successful, you know, and if it's all predicated on becoming, you know, commercially successful right away, that's not necessarily going to result in the long term, the best technologies.
Yes, I would accept that.
Yeah.
Keith Bell, you want to come in?
Yeah, just briefly, I think Tony is right to distinguish to some extent between wave and tidal technologies. My understanding is similar, that tidal is closer to being commercially viable. But I think the point you make about the difficulty getting investment is correct. My experience of talking to a colleague at the University of Strathclyde who has a proposal for a particular tidal turbine, has gone out in a spin-out company, the sort of thing that universities are supposed to do. Terrible difficulty in getting investment. And you know, actually, there's a big dependency on outfits like Scottish Enterprise, Highlands and Islands Enterprise. So, yeah, there's a tension there, obviously, between the venture capitalists who want their short, quick return and a lot of return versus some of these state-funded bodies and whether they do make mistakes. Okay, maybe they do, as Tony is suggesting. But on the other hand, you're absolutely right, that especially the less mature technologies, there will be failures. There will be things you'll try and they won't work. So we have to sort of be cognizant of that.
Okay. Joan McNaughton, briefly, if you would, please.
I think not only they may make mistakes, but I think if we're going to get the innovation we need, state funding has to be prepared to tolerate some failures, and failures which will then be written off either because the whole technology was wrong or it's at too early a stage. Tidal is very promising. A lot of the technology is mature because it's precedented in hydro, actually, the turbines. I think this brings us back to the point about long-term investing and long-term confidence, because with the resources we've got around this island, it would be a huge missed opportunity not to think in terms of how we can exploit our marine technologies.
Very briefly, Neil Stuart. Yeah.
Is going to become increasingly important in the energy system as a whole. I think there's going to be a huge global demand for innovative solutions in terms of the way we manage the energy system and things like energy storage. And I think the UK and Scotland should be alert to that and how we make more of the world-class expertise we have to some extent around this table, but also around Scotland. In terms of wave and tidal, I think we have had to reconceptualise where much of the wave and tidal sector is and that we are in a research and development phase and perhaps a demonstration phase, and therefore funding should be packaged in a way that's appropriate to that. But we're also asking we're also demanding that this research and development activity comply with rules for commercial generators. So, for example, the same grid rules that cover Long Annet cover EMEC, and there is a massive burden of grid charges. Whilst we're funding industry to research and develop, we're taking money, you know, charging disproportionate amounts of money for people to connect to the grid when they're at a research and development phase.
Need to move on again. Chick Brody.
Yes, thank you, convener. It was interesting hearing Mark talk about using words like we need a hard reset, we need a rational look, the whole research with the government is haphazard, we need a commitment. And I think all that's true, particularly when you look at the paradox of, as we found out in a meeting here one evening with the Institute of Nuclear Engineering, that it will cost us £1 billion a year just to ensure Hinkley Point, and yet that's the very sum that has been denied the CCS activity. This is all great and the information is very useful, but I want to look at the more short-term activity and while we talk among ourselves, what action we can take with the UK government in the immediate term. 2 weeks ago at the Energy and Climate Change Committee, the Cordy O'Hara, the director of UK Systems Operation and National Grid, said they had a derated capacity margin in the system of 5.1%. She then indicated that they just carried out a notice of insufficient system margin, which is the first NISM they've carried out for 5 years. So we now have questions being asked about the system margin. And then later on we had James Heapy, MP, who asked the question about the electricity capacity being 68,966 megawatts. Capacity lost has been 7,366, taking that down to 61,600. I'm coming to it. I'm sure you will wait for it, convener. Then the duration of rate of 85% meant that came down to 52,000 megawatts, when the winter outlook this year is for 54,200 megawatts. Now, while we enjoy this and enjoy these conversations, what are you doing and what are we doing to by allowing to sit back and not take on the UK government? And are we happy to have power barges, power ships on our rivers as is currently apparently being planned? What are we doing? Can I ask Niall?
Well, tell you what, view the time, Gordon MacDonald's got another point. I think I'll take Gordon's question as well, and then let as many of the panel as we can respond to both points, because otherwise we're just going to run out of time. So, Gordon.
It was just the opening remarks that Joan gave, and also about the World Energy Council report that placed the UK a negative watch for affordability. And I just want to try and understand why the government, UK government, appears to be moving away from the cheapest renewables in favour of gas and nuclear. And how do we address the subject of affordability to the public, and to industry for that matter, because that impacts on jobs?
Well, John, why don't you respond directly to that point, first of all, and then perhaps others can either come in on that or respond to Mr. Yeah. Brodie's point.
The UK was placed on negative watch because although it's maintained a high rating, it's in the top five of 130 countries. It was felt that the security of supply was under threat, this capacity margin that we've just heard about, and its affordability performance has gone down. And I think the key message that's coming out from the work we're doing with 130 countries is that you can add to the costs of decarbonisation by increasing the perception of risk and the perception of political risk. And some of the debate ahead of the UK general election on affordability just stopped quite a lot of investment because people were holding back. Now, maybe that was at times when investments should have been made. So already you've got, you know, a suboptimal outcome. If you don't know what the clear direction of policy is, then you're going to have to think in terms of it's a higher risk project, and then your cost of capital will encompass a higher risk premium. Now, that doesn't mean that you can expect or businesses expect an unchanging policy, inflexible policy. Of course, the policy has to adjust to take account of changes in circumstance, changes in cost or whatever. But what you need to do is communicate what the triggers for those changes are going to be, which could be timed review points or a percentage cost reduction or a certain level of deployment. And reading the Amber Rudd speech, one of the justifications that she gave was that because the UK is on track for its 2020 targets on wind and solar, they feel justified in looking for control of costs there. So, but that wasn't signalled before. So I think, you know, that predictability of how change is going to happen. And I think there is quite a lot, actually, that maybe could be considered in Scotland around costs within the context of the devolved powers. But that's maybe a conversation for another day.
OK, I'll take some more points. I think Keith Bell first caught my eye, and then Angus.
Yeah, the electricity security supply thing, home territory for me as an engineer. Actually, if you look at the UK government's loss of load expectation standard, which underpinned the capacity market, then a derated margin of about 5% is about the right answer. Now, you can have a discussion about what that really means in terms of whether the risks are acceptable or unacceptable. We can never have no risk. Whether the capacity market really delivers what it's supposed to, that's 2018-19 is when the capacity is supposed to be available. Will it all deliver? And that's a valid question. What happens in the meantime is a valid question. Part of me, as someone who used to work in the electricity supply industry, inevitably says, oh, they don't do things as well as they used to. But at the same time, you know, the National Grid is the system operator. The two transmission licensees in Scotland have some very professional people working in there. I have a lot of contact with them. There's some methods we can help them with in terms of, you know, academics and new things. But at a certain point, we have to trust them to get on with it and do it. And the barge, I believe that was offered. My understanding is that wasn't where they placed the contract. It was with Peterhead.
Angus.
Just
a very quick point, pulling together what we're talking about on affordability with Joanne's question about sort of UK government motivations. I think one of the motivations is concern about electricity bills. And a few years ago, after financial crisis, there was a lot of public concern about utility bills going up. Actually, gas prices went up more than electricity bills. But actually, I think the government's not looking carefully enough at its own numbers, because electricity bills went up by 25% between 2010 and 2014, but that's based on an assumption of constant use, constant kilowatt hour use. But actually, kilowatt hour use was going down. So energy efficiency and other measures were reducing the amount of electricity households were using. And if you take that into account, the increase was only 14%, not 25%. So it's still an increase, and a lot of it was not due to renewables. But the electricity bill factor is not as much of a problem, I think, as UK government says.
Felix White.
In response to Mr. Brodie's question about practical measures that can be taken in the short term, and I think in Scotland we have, and we are at risk of having, a lot more stranded assets as a result, in part, of the existing electrical infrastructure not being able to accommodate the output of operational generation schemes. So I would like to see the Scottish Investment Bank move. Ofgem's already supported this sort of model to underwrite investments that individual generators cannot themselves afford, thereby fast-track investment in infrastructure which mean that generators can operate at their full output. One step. Second step is to really encourage as much as we can the UK government to keep the focus on including within the next CFD allocation support for remote island wind. There's been a lot of effort by the Scottish Government to secure that. It's gone a bit quiet, but that's very important that comes back in, because you've got several hundred megawatts of generating capacity consented, could be built very quickly if we get security over the business model, which will come from remote island wind CFD.
Thank you. Very briefly, John Foster.
The answer to Chick's question is, what are they doing in the short term? The answer is generator farms. Diesel generator farms sharing connections with large wind and solar schemes in the south of England, and the government are subsidising them. There are 159 of them currently going for planning to get operation in the coming months. Diesel generator farms connected to existing solar and wind sites. The logic of the connection is one that, for example, solar supports with wind, because there's a very good logic where you have a wind connection and you connect solar alongside it. It's a strong potential opportunity for a lower cost solution to installing solar alongside wind in the future. And as I said earlier, we've heard it works well together. But that is what is happening right now. Ask yourself what's that.
Brief last one from Neil Stuart.
So it's been a while since I looked at the figures, but certainly over the last few years, UK has had amongst the cheapest gas prices for consumers in the EU15. It's been no worse than average in terms of electricity costs. In terms of what government can do to help the industry, the power industry, grow and deliver the power we need, in our sector, capital is a huge cost for the sector. It's been described by one of our members as the fuel of the renewable energy sector. We need certainty to bring capital into the sector and to keep costs down. That is best done by working with the industry to create a viable investment framework. And we think that is best done through the existing mechanism, which has been developed over the last 5 or 6 years, which is the contract for difference mechanism. And through that, we can secure new generation whilst putting pressure on costs and keeping bills down for consumers.
Thank you very much. Okay, on that note, we'll have to end proceedings. Can I thank all our witnesses for their time and coming along this morning? It's been very helpful. Clearly, we had a fair amount of time, but we didn't perhaps get as far into all the topics as we might have done. If any of the witnesses would like to write to the committee and add anything to their evidence, we'd be very pleased to hear from you. It would be very useful if you're able to do that, because I appreciate time was constrained. Thank you. We will now suspend and go into private session.